before it built, like originally, you know.
Yeah, probably.
Surely.
You know, the water just, you know, came out of the city system and went through with the streams.
You know the name of the town that started cleaning up Bryant Park in New York City?
That's a big issue.
Operations to the park spaces.
Because it was really, my way is that I'm just gonna get out there with garbage.
So big, and I had no idea how to operate that shit.
Yeah.
Is there a.
Oh, it was.
You were not. Right, that's when I lived, and you walked all.
Right there. You see, old quarters of the market, that stuff looks like a long time ago, but I can't. They operate.
Shirley, we gotta get going.
Okay.
Why don't you sit in, no, why don't you suggest you sit in my chair, since I'm gonna go over here. All right, so. Get comfy. Okay, we're gonna start.
We do business.
All right, so I don't know if I'm gonna finish. I was a little ambitious. And even I went through this with my husband last night, he's like, you got too much, you gotta cut it, you gotta cut it, you gotta cut it. So there, if we get to a certain point, well, if I get to a certain point and there's a, I have a stopping point, if we get through, maybe we'll get through. All of this is gonna make a lot more sense when you've read your textbook. And so this is just going to be an introduction to you of the things that you're going to read both in the textbook and in the chapter from Eden on the Charles. The idea of my presentation is for you to really understand the history of the space, the topographical changes that occurred, what the public garden looked like before it looks like it is now. And obviously, as Shirley said, you are not going to be responsible for knowing all of this, but there are little bits and pieces that you will use to build your tour. But understanding the whole background, you know, gives you that foundation to build your tour. And so we're going to start at the very beginning. So here we have the visual history of the public garden. So let's start with Bonner's view of Boston, 1722. This is about 100 years after Boston was founded. What do you see? The common is the, where is this little doodad? There you go. There is the common. And the shore of the common was the western edge of Boston. That was the end of town. So most people were over here living in the north end and around the waterfront, a little bit in the south end around here. The common was the dead end of town. And what was here? This is the Great Back Bay. It was a bay full of water. Here's the Charles River, here's the Great Back Bay. And right up against the common, it was marshland. And people in town used that marsh to swim, to fish, to shoot birds. It was a pleasant, marshy place. I also want to point out, it is from this western edge of town that the British pushed off on April 18th, 1775, to go fight in Lexington and Concord. So if you remember Paul Revere, one if by land, two if by sea, they hung two lanterns in the Old North Church. This was the sea that they rowed across to go to Cambridge.
Wasn't really a sea.
And it, well, it was a bay.
Yeah.
It was, you know, he took his poetic license.
Yeah.
It was a bay. They rowed over to Cambridge and marched to Lexington and Concord. Mm-hmm. So we do, when we give the tour, like to point that out, that that edge of the common across Charles Street is where the revolution started.
And the water was deep enough to come up to your
4 feet.
4 feet.
About 4 feet. Yeah. So that's where we are, 1722. Now, about 110 years later, here we have a ward map, but I use this to illustrate that here the common is still the dead end of town. But you now see that a mill dam has been built along what is currently, that we know as Beacon Street.
Yeah.
So a couple of decades before this, the city fathers thought, we are gonna put that water to work, we are gonna build a mill, we are gonna put 90 factories on that mill, and we are gonna be a powerhouse. Well, they built three, and it was a complete and utter disaster, because when the water flowed out, this receiving basin was a mud hole. And so this area that had been this lovely marshy place to swim and fish and everything was just a mud flat that was really unsightly and smelled terribly. And people were very, very, very unhappy about that. and didn't, you know, what are we going to do? What are we going to do? This is a map from just a year later with some infrastructure laid over it. You see the receiving basin, you see the common here, and you see the shape of what will become the public garden.
Oh my goodness.
And what happened was, it was a fellow named Horace Gray, and he and about 16 of his friends formed a proprietorship, went to the city and said, we would like to take this land and fill it in and make a garden. And the city said, oh well, okay. So from the very beginning, it was a public-private partnership. It was the city's land, but a private group filled it in, and for about 13 years ran a public garden here. So when we say the public garden started in 1837, it did in fact with this private group. They had a greenhouse and a few other things on the land. This is one of the few views that we have of what we call, you know, I'm calling Horace Gray's public garden. And this was a view that was, it's an etching done in 1850, which is about the year he ran out of money. And that the city received the land back and became caretakers of the garden. What we're looking at, we're looking from the west, looking east to the harbor. You see the town has really built up. Here's Beacon Hill, here's our common, and here's our garden. And it is very much like the shape of the 24 acres that we have now. There's some trees, they have a little pond in the middle. There was a greenhouse, they had flower exhibitions then. That is, you can see the beginning of houses on Beacon Street and Boylston Street. This is the view backwards, a few years later, from the top of the State House. So we're looking east, looking west. Here you see again the Great Back Bay, the Charles River, here's the Mill Dam. This row of trees is the edge of the public garden. Here's the pond, and I want you to see that there's the greenhouse. This is where Arlington Street would be started just a few years later.
So there was no division between the river and the bay? It was all...
Well, until they built the mill dam, no. It was a tidal river.
Okay. And,
so that shows you, you know, pretty much the public garden as it looked in that time.
Did they just not understand when they built the mill dam that it was going to cause...
No.
Such a mess.
No, they really thought there would be enough power, and
the water would flow more evenly, and there wasn't.
It was a mechanical failure.
Mm-hmm. You'll read a bit in that book, in this book.
Okay. Yeah.
If you really want to know, it covers in great detail. Very interesting.
And so, what they thought and why didn't work.
And
so I'm just kind of giving you the highlights that you will read in depth about. So what happened is, in about 1850, the decade from the 50s to the 60s was one in which the citizens and the city fought over the public garden. And the city said, aha, land, we're taking it, we're going to build on it, goodbye to your garden. And the citizens said, no, this is our birthright, just as the common is our birthright, it was part of the common. You cannot take away something that is public land. We want it. And you will read in detail about the fights that went on and the laws that had to be enacted to make the public garden ever an open space for the public, which it is. We're going to show a few more pictures. So what was happening during the 10 years? I mean, was it derelict? No, it wasn't derelict. The city was taking care of it. And in fact, here we have Oliver Wendell Holmes and Ralph Waldo Emerson. Oh, wait, so I remember, there's the greenhouse. So there they are. This is up. This is Beacon Street. I want you to see the split rail fence. It was very rustic originally. And do you see the slope? The original garden was 4 feet lower than it is right now. So when the city did take it over a few years later, they filled in the 4 feet to make it street level. But it wasn't without sinkholes. I mean, it was tidal river under there, you know, whatever. But here they are in front of the greenhouse, and that's where they propagated flowers and had flower shows. And so the public used it. The public used it during the years it was in contention. Now I'll show you this, that as early as 1850, which is the year that Horace Gray ceded the public garden to the city, there were plans to build on the public garden. This was our first big fight. And you know, this is what
we
done.
Didn't exist.
Yeah.
Right. No, I just mean
just neighbors.
Right. The public garden. This is where the public gardens, the first fight over the public garden. And here you can see a plan for over 200 houses that the city wanted to put there. And again, the citizens said, no, you can't do that. So after all this contentious debate, there were these acts passed, and it was made a park forever, and they had a competition to redesign the park. So this is the winning design by a man named George Meacham in 1859, and what you see is pretty much the park today in terms of the pond in its irregular shape, the bridge going across, and the meandering paths. That was all a part of his original plan. What didn't happen were his parterre gardens here. They were very formal. That didn't happen. The children's playground didn't happen. And the building, which was supposed to be City Hall, did not happen. That, again, was a big debate. People were like, no. This is a garden. We don't want any buildings in it. So, but you see he had the basins that we know with the fountains and everything. But people didn't stop trying to put buildings there. The very next year, somebody wanted to put a conservatory. Look, just straddle the fountains, you know. But again, it didn't happen. So we get a few years later. Here's a bird's eye view of Boston in 1870. So again, west looking east. And you can see there's the common, here's the public garden, and here are the first few blocks of the Back Bay being built out. We're going to flip that view. So now we are again back at the State House looking west. Here, the common, the public garden. There's George Washington. There's the Commonwealth Avenue Mall.
Oh, great.
And just the first few blocks of, so that's Arlington Street Church, and that's Emmanuel on Newbury Street. So that's what it looked like. We'll go back to a close-up. Here you see a glass greenhouse was in the public garden, George Washington, and a few other objects that we'll see. Here's Boylston as residential. You'll also see the trees are on three sides of the common. I mean, of the public garden, but for whatever reason, Arlington Street was not planted out in trees till a much, much later time, and we'll see some pictures of that. So this is a very early photograph of the public garden as by George Meacham's plan. So you have a greenhouse, and you have the basins, and you have this, which we will see many images of, our very first object, our sculpture, and that is the Maid of the Mist, or the Venus sculpture that was in the fountain here. But this predates, we know it's around 1867 because that's the year that the bridge was built, but none of our sculpture is there yet. In fact, the very first piece of sculpture to go into the public garden was Edward Everett. He was the governor of Massachusetts, a senator, the secretary of state, ambassador to Great Britain, and for a short time, the president of Harvard. In other words, a great man. And it made sense that Edward Everett would be the person. He had died in 1865, and his friend said, we need a sculpture of him, and it should go in the public garden. Well, from the outset, it was pretty much laughed at. It was done in a style that already, when it went up, was out of date. It was vastly overscaled. I mean, look how huge it is compared to the people standing here.
Oh, yeah.
So this would have been on Beacon Street, kind of across right where the Hampshire House is, right there in the public garden. And the big joke about it was, it just looks like he's hailing a cab. He was removed from the public garden in 1911 and now is in Everett Square in Dorchester, which was his birthplace. But that was our first sculpture. Second sculpture is the Ethan Monument. I'm not going to talk a lot about these because we will be learning about these in depth in the weeks to come, and you will be educating each other about them. But this was in 1868.
And behind it is the ginkgo tree.
Oh, well, there it is.
There it is. So we know it must have been there in 1868.
That's right.
Isn't that it?
Is that, yeah,
are we looking in the other direction?
I think
that's behind him.
I think the ginkgo tree is right here.
Yeah,
the ginkgo tree is right in front.
He's looking at the ginkgo.
Yeah.
Oh, okay. So that's not the ginkgo.
Okay. So then we have ether. George Washington, which is, you know, very, very famous. It's Thomas Ball. It's a great story. It's one of the highlights of our tour, and you'll be learning a lot about George. This is a view that's hard to visualize because this fountain is no longer there. There are the two on the Arlington Street side and the two on the Charles Street side. But there was this fifth fountain that was paved over in the 20s when the George Robert White Memorial was put in the corner of Arlington and Beacon. But this fountain was on the axis of Ether and George Washington. So that is a sight line that we don't see because we've got big trees, really, really big trees. The Japanese pagoda tree, for one, is there. And you don't really see that view anymore. But that is an early view. Here's another early view. This is when Boylston was a residential neighborhood, and this is looking across. There's George, there's Ether, of course the bridge, and the houses on Beacon Street, and you can even see over to the river.
Oh my goodness.
Here is the greenhouse that was in the public garden from 1861 to 1878. Everything that was grown for the public garden was done right here. I mean, Franklin Park didn't exist. You will see the greenhouses next week. You will see the incredible work they do out there. But before that, it all took place here. The person in charge of the public garden for many years was a man named John Galvin. And in 1878, he turned his job over to someone named William Doog, who really is the person that shaped the plantings of the garden as we know it today. And William Doog got to the public garden and said, tear that thing down. He didn't like it at all. But it was fortuitous that they were building Franklin Park and he could get his 12 greenhouses out there. So
Franklin Park dates to 1878?
I think it's slightly later, but it was being planned.
You'll see, it's in bad repair.
Bad. And the oldest of the greenhouses has been torn down, that one that was up on the hill.
Yeah.
But anyway, there was this greenhouse. Here's a view from one of the fountains and some people admiring the spray. Here is a view from Arlington Street in 1889. This is what I mean by the rest of the edges were really planted out with trees. You can see some mature trees here, in fact. But Arlington Street itself was quite bare. This is later, and you can see that you've got saplings and the trees have been planted. And you've got telegraph wires of some sort going across the street. Maybe it's electricity. The Maid of the Mist. She's kind of like our ducklings today. Everybody had to go see her. This is what you find the most postcards and photographs of. She is variously called Venus on the Half Shell, Maid of the Mist, Venus at her bath. And she was there from before 1867 until the 1920s. So there are lots of pictures of her. Here she is with George Washington. Here she is in 1900 at the height of our Victorian gardens. And William Doog was the superintendent from 1878 to 1906. His imprint is everywhere, from the tropical plants that we still put out every summer. And you think, why? Why do we do that? Well, because that's what they did, and so we still do it. This is Boston. And the rich masses of plantings that he dug, that he designed, which were the height of the Victorian fashion, and you will read a lot about, and we will talk about, but he planted in a style called bedding out, or carpet bedding, where you packed these beds just so tightly with lots and lots of very colorful plants. And so when you go into the public garden today, you think, why did they do this? And it really is because that's the way every garden was done in the 1800s, and we've just continued it. We have new plant materials, and we make it more interesting every year, but it really is, you'll hear Anthony Hennessy say, I am a disciple of William Doog, and this is what I do. That you will see the tropicals that are stored overwintered in the greenhouses. And in fact, there are the famous Boston palms that got too big and too heavy to even bring from the greenhouses to the public garden. in the 60s. So this is something that has always been. Here she is with the water on. I love that one. And you see the great Boston Palm. I mean, imagine carting that from Franklin Park every year. Really?
1902.
Yep.
Skirt looks a little short.
Well, just that
little girl.
It's a little girl, but we got, if it's a real date, I really, it's a real date.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Here she is in 1909. I love the lily pads. I just think that's great. Isn't that great? Mm-hmm. And then we get to 1933, and it's like, what happened? Mm-hmm. Well, you can still see the ring of spray.
Yeah.
But she's been replaced with a monk. And sometimes the book says, it was a modesty issue. I don't think it was a modesty issue. I think she was corny and out of date, and people are like, that is so Victorian, get her out of here. She's now on the North Shore somewhere. We don't know where. But for a few years, this statue is there, but very shortly after, we have our small child. The book says that we acquired her in 1929, but we have a date on the photograph of that other from 1933, so we're going to say small child went in after 1933 because of the date of the photograph. So this is what is there now, and when you learn about the four basins and the four statues, what's really nice is that they are all 20th century, they're all done, sculpted by women, and they all feature something from childhood. So that's a really nice unifying theme for our basins right now and a great highlight of the tour.
When you say, sorry, it was acquired, does that mean it was made for a different space and then brought to
This was given to us. It was made for us. But what I did find out, if we get to it, about Bagheera, which is the panther in one of the basins, is that that the sculptor did it in 1939, and we didn't get it until 1986. So
it was living somewhere for 50 years.
Yeah, yeah. So, but this one was given to us in 1929 and went in sometime after 33. And something else that you will learn about when Lynn Padgett comes to talk to us is the history of the Swan boats. They have always been with us. Her great-great-grandfather started the company. He had a rowboat company, and he also had some paddle wheels. This is the Dolly Varden with a paddle wheel. He had rowboats, and you can see that there was a gazebo where our island is now. Great stories about the gazebo is that it was a peninsula. You could walk out there, and our friend William Dube decided this was a bad thing because the young people were going out there for trysts, and so he had it cut off, turned into an island. The gazebo went away, but this is what it looked like before he took that action. We know the Swan boats arrived after 1877, and you'll learn the story about how that happened, but here they are in 1880, looking pretty much like we see them today. Ours are bigger, but same concept. It's a really wonderful part of the public garden. Now, the tulips. What do you think of when you think of the public garden? You think of our tulip displays. We plant 35,000 tulips every year, and guess what? We pretty much always have. The very first tulips exhibited in the United States were shown in 1840. In the public garden. So Horace Gray introduced the tulip, and they've been here ever since. William Dube boasted in the 1880s that New York is just now starting to plant out tulips, and we have done it forever. It really is our signature flower, and again, these are planted densely, usually single color in a bed, and is very much a part of his planting scheme.
Where is that?
That's just,
I think it's the spine going,
the bridge. Yeah.
Do you plant new bulbs every year?
Every year.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
They'll talk
so you
to
can,
about that.
You see the bridge?
Mm-hmm. Oh, that's the bridge.
Yeah, and that's Arlington Street. So
oh,
they're just.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's just an unusual. See, there's the swan boat
angle.
Right, I get it.
Yeah, good.
Yeah. So that's that. So these, I just have a few just to plant out what I mean about, to show you what I mean about the carpet bedding and the tight planting. I mean, he just like went nuts. Here we are, just a riot of color. Even look up on top of the.
No, it could be today.
It could be today. This I show you. We know it's after 1917 because this building is the building that we are in right now. Was built in 1917. But what I picked this slide was to show you that finally there are mature trees. Where there had not been, there had been vast expanses that were treeless. Finally we have our tree canopy. And so one of the things that we talk about on the tour is the high canopy and the low canopy of our specimen trees and then our flowering trees below, which we'll talk more about. Now, so that is our building where we are, but let's take a look at it in 1870. This is 67, 68, and 69 Beacon Street. That's what was here.
Oh my goodness.
And there's the gate right across the street.
1870.
Yeah. So, and then if you were to walk inside the gate and turn around and look at it, that's what you would be looking at.
So that tree.
I don't think that tree is there. Those trees, those are where the dog are. Then if you were to turn around, and what would your view have been walking down the path? There you'd see. This is prior to 1926, because 1926 is when the Ritz, a.k.a. the Taj, was built. But you've got the Arlington Church and that nice block. And here that is today, pretty much. Taking my spray out there.
Not many trees, though, in that previous one.
No, not too many in 26 on that side.
Not many.
Well, it's prior. I mean, it could. Prior. Yeah, it could. I don't have a day.
But
big,
we said 1917.
So then there we are with our willows. Now I do have time. I didn't think I was going to get to this. Our tour does not go over to the Boylston Street edge because we don't have enough time for that. But we do like for everybody to learn everything about the sculpture that's over there and what it looks like and the work that we do over there. So I've got a series of pictures that relate to this. So this is standing in the public garden looking straight on at the Arlington Street Church.
Oh my goodness.
I mean, there's nothing, just nothing there. We don't know what date it is. We do know it's prior to 1903. We know that because the Channing Memorial went in 1903. Cass, Thomas Cass, we will be learning about him, went in 1899. And he is not where he currently is today. He was placed much closer to George Washington. There's George Washington. And was not moved into the Boylston Street edge until 1915. So just because something's someplace now doesn't mean it always was. This is Boylston Street from the corner of Arlington looking down toward Charles. And what you see is here is the fence that very soon will be lost and was not replaced until late in the 20th century. Here you have houses. And what you see here are streetcar tracks. Did anybody see the show on the subways, yes. PBS? Yes. So you know that there were all these competing streetcar companies in Boston. It was chaos. The streets were completely crushed and you couldn't get through. And so finally the city just said, we're taking everything over. We're going to run the transit system. And P.S. we're putting some of it underground. And where they were going to put some of it underground is right here, which this became the next great threat to the public garden. First we had the threat of the city wanting to build houses on the public garden. Now we have the threat of the land grab, and they did grab about 2 acres on the Boylston Street side to build the subway. But while before they did that, they had to do a tree survey. So Historic New England has the glass plates that belong to the Boston Transit Association. And here we have somebody with 289 in front of a tree. And they went around and surveyed all the trees and decided which ones they would tear down, you know, cut down, and which ones they thought they could salvage when they were building the subway.
Oh, yeah.
And here it is. Here's the subway coming out of that just pretty much on Boylston Street where we were looking at. Now here's Thomas Sumner. What I like about this is he has got his back to the street and is looking in to the public garden. And was that way for many years until he all of a sudden turned around. Because the subway entrance was subsequently buried. And so while we don't have our fence back here, you see the public garden was just open to the street and was for decades, at least there was a sense that we didn't have the subway right in our park, and they put it all underground. And then very shortly after that, here is the Wendell Phillips Memorial that Sumner and Cass is down there. And then this, that ramp gets buried. Beth and I found this when we were looking through pictures. I just thought it was fun to put it in there. There's Edward Hale. And let's see, how does he relate to Edward Everett? Edward Everett was his uncle. Edward Everett Hale, we will learn about when we do our sculptures. He did end up there, but they're all deciding, is that right? How do we want to turn him? And when you see, when you go up and you look at the sculpture, you see that the base is cracked, and Sarah Hutt, our sculpture care person, is always like, oh yeah, we don't know how to take care of that. Well, the reason is because it's all one piece. Like, this disc is connected to the plinth that's connected to him. Oh. And so it's like, why did they do that? I don't know. But there they were trying to figure out where to put him, and he ended up pretty much right there. So here's just another example of things that have changed. This is, as I was talking about, this is Bagheera, which is in one of the fountains that's on the Charles Street side. But for many years, we had this gremlin on a rock. I don't know anything about him other than that's where he was, and that's what replaced him and is there now. So I thought that was amusing. This is my final slide. It's not in the public garden. It is actually just across the street, the Commonwealth Avenue Mall. This is Alexander Hamilton, who predates his friend George Washington. George Washington did not go in until 1869. Alexander Hamilton went in 1865. But when they face each other, and when we do the tour, we love to point that out.
And of course, everyone knows about Hamilton.
Now, exactly. Right. But look at that. Look at Commonwealth Avenue. Oh, sorry.
There's trees and
the spindly trees, and there's just the first block is built on that side, very little on that side.
Wow.
Mm-hmm. So it really shows you how things have come. I don't go past this into the 20th century, and so mine doesn't bump up against Liz's precisely, but what we know happened is that the garden fell into great disrepair because the tax base of Boston disappeared. In the 40s and 50s, there was a great flight from the city to the suburbs, and when you lose people, you lose the taxes, and what's the first thing to get cut? Parks. And so the decline of the parks really is what it was the impetus for the founding of the Friends. And so we have taken this on. Shirley always likes to quote Henry.
Yeah, Henry says we need vigilance, constant vigilance.
And I would encourage you, if you want to see more pictures like this, Digital Commonwealth, Boston Athenaeum Online, cool. And Historic New England Online have a lot of wonderful images. So you can just go there. And
this is great.
Thanks.
Really?
No, thanks. So I had to cut so much. I was like, no. I mean, I had like 50 more slides. It's like, just like you got to cut it. It's just sagging. Oh. I was like, but this is the nerd's approach. Anyway, thank you. Thank you, Mr.